Welcome to the First Presbyterian Church on this Sunday, November 8th. Join me in our call to worship. O God, you are my God. I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My very flesh faints for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water. I have found your steadfast love, which is better than life. I will lift up my hands, I will call upon your name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning, it's time to sing your song. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy. Your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on saying. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy. Time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship. worships your holy name. Yes, I will worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never.
Join me in our prayer of confession. Fountain of life, we have drunk from dusty wells of our own making. Bread of heaven, we have set our table with the meager fruits of our own labor. We have sought riches in bankrupt storehouses of our own building. Forgive us for turning away from your generous grace. Satisfy our hunger with your bounty, and we may praise you joyfully, cling to you only, seek you wholly, and tell of your goodness gladly. Amen. Thank you. What would you think if I stood up here and said, I have 3 easy steps for childbirth? Of course, the first thing you might notice is that I'm a man. But beyond that fact, that's just crazy. There's nothing easy about childbirth. You're not going to find 3 easy steps for childbirth. Well, I have a question for you. Why do you think your spiritual birth is going to be any easier than your natural birth? Here we are in this human condition. There is a gap within me, a gap between intention and reality, a gap between what I would like and what actually happens in my life. There is a gap that the Apostle Paul spoke about. Now, wait a minute. It's Paul. Wouldn't he have his life all together? And Paul writes this in Romans 7, verse 15. What I don't understand about myself is that I decide one way, but then I act another, doing things I absolutely despise. A gap. Though I find myself in good company, not just with the Apostle Paul, but say someone like Thomas A. Kempis, when you read his deep longing in his book, The Imitation of Christ, when you take in the deep angst of Augustine as he writes his Confessions, when you experience the intensity of Teresa of Avila in her book, The Interior Castle. And in fact, when we see Jesus in Mark 1:12, at once this same spirit, this spirit that came down upon him at his baptism, this same spirit that filled him, drives him out into the wild, into the wilderness to be tested and tempted, to be tried. So on this Sunday, we're talking about the first of those threefold ways on purgation, on purifying the heart. Our text is from Mark chapter 8, 34 to 36. Then Jesus called the crowd to him along with his disciples. So everyone's there. This isn't like he here, just for you disciples or just for this little group. He says, no, everybody, y'all come here. This is important. And he said, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for my sake and for the gospel will save it. What good is it if someone gained the whole world and lost and forfeited their own soul? Take up your cross. A Roman cross is only good for one thing. It's an execution. It's where you die. That's the only thing that happens on a cross. What we're speaking about is mortification, being killed by degree. We're more familiar with mortification in the sense of a mortgage. In a mortgage, you can't afford to buy the house in one go, so you pay for it over 15 or 30 years in little bits. Same thing with mortification. In little bits, God calls us to deny ourselves, to die to what was old, to what's broken within us, to what is in the darkness within us, and slowly allow new life to come where there was brokenness and hurt and harm. But it's slowly, God slowly reveals our sin and brokenness. He does this because if we truly comprehended how shattered we are, how far from God we are, it would be overwhelming. So God doesn't do that. God just deals with us slowly, slowly. Cycles of small surrenders and little deaths and little growths. We've talked for 2 months about changing the narrative and stories of our lives, how we cling to old stories that are no longer adequate for our lives, stories that aren't true, stories that don't jive with this great story that God is calling us into. And yet we cling to them because they're familiar. We cling to them because they've become precious to us. And it's a little death when we give up a story that's been so important to us to adopt a fresh and new story that's more real. One of the great challenges we have in the church is that we have so many adults with childish faith, not childlike faith, childish faith. They're adults. They're trying to deal with adult things with a third grade faith. And they're wondering why they're struggling. We want people to grow and grow up and have an adult faith for adult challenges. Back when I was really just getting going with Jesus Christ, there was a group of us who wanted more. And so our pastor met with us for 8 weeks at 6 o'clock in the morning on Saturday morning. That was the only time we could all come. I went to work at 7 o'clock every morning, and the church was just down from where I worked, so I could stay there till about 10 to 7. And so we got together 8 weeks. Can you imagine this? 20 people getting together for 8 weeks at 6 o'clock in the morning. We went through a book called Habitation of Dragons. Doing the same thing we're talking about here. Habitation of Dragons uses the image of a lake. Our life is like this lake, and there are just unknowable depths down within us and down in this lake. But every once in a while, a dragon erupts out of the lake, and we have to deal with the dragon. It takes time and effort to deal with the dragon. The dragon has to be killed. And then there's a time when things are placid again, and we kind of regroup ourselves, and then another dragon comes out. And it's a mercy that we don't know how deep that lake is and how many dragons are down in there, that we are a habitation of dragons. But those dragons, we have to have a purgation. We have to purify the heart, and it goes little at a time, little deaths and small growths. One of the things that happened to me happened in January of 1999. Now, I'd been going on with God for quite a while by that point. I'd been a pastor a long time, and I had been a National Guard chaplain for quite a while, and this would only happen in the National Guard. I went to California in 1991, and I joined the California Army National Guard, and I went to 1st Tank, this tank battalion headquartered out of San Bernardino. And I stayed there for 9 years. See, in active army, a chaplain wouldn't stay in one place for 9 years. But in the Army Guard, these things happen. And so when I got there in 1991, there was this captain who very quickly went on to other things. And late in 1998, that captain came back as a freshly minted lieutenant colonel and now the battalion commander. And he and I got crossways. And most of the fault was mine. I was kind of, on one hand, guy, I knew you when you didn't wear, you only wore short pants. I knew you when you were just a captain, you see. But he wasn't a captain. He was now the lieutenant colonel and the battalion commander. And he and I got crossways, and there was resentment in me. And I was nurturing this little ball of bitterness. And I was feeding it, and I was taking care of it, and I was letting it grow. And I got in my car in January of 1999 to drive up to the armory to go for a drill. And I was going north up Interstate 15, and this thought just came fully formed in my mind. You might say God spoke to me. This thought just dropped on me. If you cannot respect and follow the battalion commander you can see, you are lying to yourself about how well you respect and follow Jesus Christ, who you cannot see. Oh. And on that drive up, I had to let go of that resentment. I had to give up that ball of bitterness that I'd invested myself in, and I'd put so much time and effort in, and I had nurtured that bitterness, and I had to let it go. I had to let it die. And I had to have a, if you would have come to Jesus moment for Bob Field, and commit myself that I was going to do everything I could to make that battalion commander successful. And it weeks and weeks went by, it kept dwelling in there about how immediate our relationship to God has something to do with our relationship to people. That you can't just go off and be spiritual and not have it down in the earth about how we treat and respect and care for one another. I had to die a little bit on that drive up to San Bernardino that day. Be able to open to something better. Now, spiritual disciplines, they're disciplines that can help us in this purgation. There certainly are struggles with temptation. I have noticed for a long time that people that work 12-step programs are, on the whole, better people. Just all around better people. That's because they've learned how to struggle with temptation. They don't have illusions about themselves and know how to reach out for help in that struggle. And it makes them just better people. And of course, the really big one that touches our lives is hurt. It's suffering. It's loss. Those things that come and they either deepen our lives or they derail our life with Christ. We either get better or we get bitter. There was a woman in my congregation back in California, and she liked controlling things. She wanted her life under control, and her husband was very definitely under control. And her husband had the nerve to get heart disease. And he went in for open heart surgery, and the surgeons did the best they could, but his veins and his arteries, they just would not hold the stitches well, and they were leaking, and the guy, you know, he did all he could do, but he came out and said, I'm worried because the material of those veins, materials that we use, they're just not holding well, and I don't think it's going to turn out well. And he was very honest with this woman. And the next day, one of them burst and he died. And she was furious. She was so angry. She was angry at her husband because this did not fit her plan to have him go and die. Furious at the hospital, furious at the doctor, and boy, was she mad at God. This was not how things were supposed to be run in her world. She hated being a widow. She talked about how much she despised the fact she'd go out with friends and they would have dinner, and she'd have to go up and pay her own bill at the restaurant instead of her husband doing it. That anger exposed deep brokenness in her, places where she needed to change the narrative of her life, including how much we can be in control of things. And when I left, she was still very much in the anger. I don't know how it turned out for her. Philippians 3:10, Paul writes, I want to know Christ. That's the third of these. That's the matured Christ, union with Christ. But he says, yes, to know the power of Christ's resurrection. That's the second one, illumination, enlightening the mind. And he goes on, and participation in his sufferings, becoming like Jesus in his death. That's the one we have been talking about, purgation, purifying the heart. Jesus invites us to come and die. There are no shortcuts to being born by the Spirit. But every death opens us up to new life and to growth. Our spiritual disciplines this week is we have a meditation, actually five different meditations. They'll be in our website at fbclubbock.org. And they'll be in our In Touch. Today we're at the baptismal. remembering that we are baptized, that God is working to integrate our lives fully into Christ Jesus, one in Christ. This is a poem. In deepest night, in darkest days, when harps are hung, no songs we raise, when silence must suffice as praise, yet sounding in us quietly, there is the song of God. Bringing our prayers for others today, I want to remember the folks, especially in the West, especially in California, still dealing with fires. We now have, right, here comes another hurricane. We have folks that are just dealing with the troubles that come in life. And with special emphasis on Peggy, who we're waiting for her surgery, let us pray together. Lord God, we do pray for others. We come up out of ourselves. We remember that we're baptized in you, and in that process, we are baptized into this people of God that cares beyond ourselves. We think of those who are involved and lives have been so touched by fires across the West, especially those in California and on the West Coast and Oregon. We rejoice that some snow and some moisture and cooler weather has helped in some of the other fires. For those who found hurricane after hurricane coming up through the Gulf of Mexico, and as they deal with the latest, we pray for Peggy as she looks forward to getting her cancer surgery behind her. We pray for our communities. We deal with this outbreak of COVID-19 where people are just not caring for one another. And so we have this outbreak and elective surgeries canceled like Peggy's, and help us to do what's necessary to protect one another. We bring our folks to you. We bring Lewis, Jerry and Jenny, Stephanie, Tommy, Frank, Jennifer, Braxton, Carol, Modesta, Jonathan, Conley, and Baylor. We lift up Pastor Becky Fox at Covenant Presbyterian Church here in Lubbock. And Lord, we bring ourselves. We do that using that prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we prepare to go and serve the Lord, I invite you to stand wherever you are. May we know more and more every day the goodness and beauty of the Lord. Amen.